Please pray with me. God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be pleasing to you. It's in your name we pray. Amen. Well, whenever I go to an LGBT event like Pride last night, I'm always a little nervous about how I will be perceived. When I say that I'm a pastor, there are many in the LGBT community who feel betrayed. I think if they felt free to voice it, they might say something like, "How can you be working for the enemy?" Catherine Matthews Huey, who writes biblical commentary sermon seeds for the UCC, asked us UCC preachers to consider a question this week. Her question is, how did the church move so far away from being a place of worship to being to being perceived by many as a place of judgment instead? The gospel passage we read this morning is all about welcome. It comes at the end of this long speech that Jesus is giving to the disciples about taking their faith and hitting the road. In the chapter before this morning's reading, Jesus instructs the disciples that they are to head out with a message, with the good news that the kingdom has come near. And Jesus instructs them to continue doing the work that he has been doing, healing and caring for those. Interestingly, he instructs them much more about how they are to show the gospel through what they do than through what they say or what they teach. They are to head out vulnerable, without supplies, without defenses, utterly dependent on the hospitality of others, on those who might recognize Jesus in them and welcome them into their homes because of that. Jesus warns the disciples that they won't always be well received, that their gospel message and they themselves may be rejected. Well, as I read through the gospel passage this week, I couldn't help but hear the story that the dominant majority Christian voice in our country has told for years. It's a story about hospitality, and it goes a little like this. The gospel, the good news, is that you are welcome in our home, as long as we live by our rules. We will see Christ in you if you conform yourself to be just like us. We will see the sacredness of your humanity if you repent of being you. If you deny the goodness of the movement of the Spirit in your life of otherness and become just like us, then we will extend God's gracious hospitality. It's often referred to as tough love. Well, not surprisingly, many have not felt so welcome by this message. And when the people who haven't felt welcome by this message have rejected it, have rejected that gospel, those who have been proclaiming it look at passages like this 10th chapter of John, or of Matthew, and they say, "Look, see, we're being rejected because of the gospel we're offering." I, like many of you, have a few problems with this dominant Christian narrative in our country. For one thing, when Jesus talks to the disciples about how they will be rejected, he's not talking to them about being rejected for the judgment they pass in Jesus' name. He's talking to them about being rejected because of the radical hospitality and the healing and the love they will offer. They will be rejected just as Jesus was, because there will be those who do not want to hear that prostitutes or tax collectors or sinners or the disabled are a part of the kingdom of God. People who want the kingdom of God to be just for themselves and their families won't want to hear this message that the kingdom of God has drawn near to everyone. Okay, so that's my first problem with it. My second problem is this. When Jesus talks to the disciples about the kind of rejection they will experience, he talks to them about something that will happen when they make themselves vulnerable. When they leave their places of power and enter someone else's home, live on their terms by the gifts they give. Too often, the Christians we see on the news are shouting their gospel from behind barriers and walls, from within their own homes, within their own houses of worship, surrounded by a throng of people who think just like they do. Places where they are in control. They claim to have a corner on truth, a corner on the Spirit, that they are the only dispensers of God's grace, that they have the power to hold back or to give the living waters of Christ. What Jesus challenged the disciples to do was to go out there into the world and open their eyes to the ways the Spirit was already moving all around them. He wanted them to go out and recognize faith, recognize the movement of the Spirit by paying close attention to the hospitality they were offered. He told them, pay such close attention that you won't even miss a single cup of water offered to you. Because surely anyone offering love and hospitality was certainly operating out of the love of God. When we live in someone else's home, and perhaps you have before, we get so close to them, we get this window into their lives. And when we humbly receive someone else's gifts of hospitality, gratitude becomes the forefront, and judgment falls by the wayside. I think this is what Jesus wanted the disciples to experience, that the kingdom of God was already near to many who they would meet, and that their proclamation to them would simply be to point this out and to receive the gifts and the hospitality they had to give them. The Presbyterian Church, at its most recent biannual general assembly, and at the one before that, made a number of decisions to recognize and affirm the ministry and the marriages of LGBT persons in our midst. The churches in our denomination who pushed for this change were not surprisingly the ones who already had LGBT folks ministering among them, living among them. John Russell Stranger, who is a minister working at Presbyterian Welcome in New York City, wrote a letter to the Presbytery of New York prior to this most recent vote. And this is what he said. He didn't talk about the Bible. He talked about the triune God and specifically about the Spirit. He said, "I have felt and seen the Spirit of Christ at work in the lives of same-sex couples. I cannot deny it. The loving relationships of same-sex couples testify to the church about the nature of the living God, who creates life abundant, who bears fruit, and places our denomination neglects." You know, often when this passage from Matthew is preached, the message to the congregation is about learning how to give hospitality. That's a good message. But when Jesus is talking to the disciples, it's not about giving hospitality that he's teaching them about. It's about learning how to receive it. I'm really glad, honestly, that this passage is not so much about giving hospitality as receiving it, because as I said before, you are phenomenal at giving hospitality as a congregation. I think I have more to learn from you than to teach you about giving hospitality. But I wonder how good we are at receiving it. What do you think? Do we know how to allow ourselves to be dependent be vulnerable enough that we open ourselves to receive their care. Those of you who work in the food pantry, those of you who serve at the women's shelter, those of you who were at Pride last night, how much have you let other people care for you? How much have you been willing to receive the gifts they have to give you? You see, we're called, of course, to serve others, to welcome others, but sharing the gospel isn't just about offering something someone doesn't already have. Sometimes it's about paying such close attention that we notice Christ already in them, that we see the fruits of the Spirit already in their lives, and we receive and affirm what they have to offer. Jesus, in our passage today, is talking to missionaries, evangelists, disciples who are going to go out and share the gospel. And I know that there are probably many of us who don't really feel like we are missionaries or evangelists, or don't feel particularly comfortable with that. I think we don't feel particularly comfortable forcing something on someone that we know might make them feel uncomfortable, that we know might not be experienced as good news. A lot of preachers will tell you, ignore those instincts, push yourself out of your comfort zone, share the gospel even if it feels horribly uncomfortable. Well, I'm going to tell you there's something in your instincts that might be on to something. In college, I was in a class called Evangelism and Discipleship. We were given the assignment to evangelize someone, basically to convert someone, and the professor of this class was under the impression and the belief that you could count the number of souls that you saved. Now, as you can imagine, I was very uncomfortable with this assignment, and part of that was because it demanded more extroversion than my introvert self wanted to muster. But part of it was that it just didn't feel right. In my fumbling attempts to try to fulfill this assignment, I ended up doing some serious damage to a friendship I had with someone. And years later, after I had a lot more life experience and a lot more theological training, I realized how crazy it had been to attempt to do the work that only God could do. I couldn't convert someone, only the Spirit could. And the truth was that regardless of what she chose to call it, the Spirit was alive and at work in my friend's life. She in many ways reflected Christ's love more than I myself did. I had to go back to her years later and apologize profusely for the ways I had hurt her by thinking that I had something to give her that she didn't already have. One of the best stories of evangelism I have heard is in Donald Miller's book, Blue Like Jazz. I don't agree with all of Miller's theology, but I find this one story absolutely brilliant. He describes how right in the middle of a very hippie, free-loving, liberal campus of Reed College, where most students are highly skeptical if not morally opposed to institutional religion, he and his friends, a small group of Christian students at the school, decided that they were going to set up a booth right down the middle of campus, set up a booth, and paint on it the words, Confession Booth. It was the weekend of a big campus-wide school-sponsored rave, and everyone was drunk and high. And students wandered into their booth, wondering, what in the world is a group of Christian students doing in the middle of the lawn with people streaking by naked, painted blue? They wandered in and they asked, do you want us to confess our sins? Do you want us to tell you about all the stuff we've been doing at this rave? To their surprise, Miller and his friends did not want to receive their confessions. They wanted to offer a confession to them. They wanted to confess and to apologize for all the things that have been done in the name of Christ that have hurt others. To ask their forgiveness and their grace. You see, somehow they recognize that even these drunk, high, nude, painted blue people had something of God's Spirit in them, had something of God's love to offer them. And they were surprised to find how hospitable these Reed students were, how moved they were. I wonder what would happen next year if at the St. Pride Street Festival we showed up with a confession booth. What a different form of evangelism that would be, huh? To make ourselves vulnerable, to admit that we are part of the broken body of Christ, to recognize that those outside the church might also have the Spirit, to ask them for the cool water of their forgiveness and grace. How different that would look. We know how to give hospitality. I pray that God will teach us also how to receive it.